Hello, my name is Keshwani.
That's K-E-S-H-W-A-N-I,
Keshwani. We are here because we want to prepare for the HESI. We have been solving math problems out of this book here, the HESI Admission Assessment Exam Review, the third edition. If you do not own this book already, purchase one immediately. You're going to need it. Right now, we are in the process of solving problems having to do with the notion of multiplication of fractions. Multiplications of fractions, and we are on page number 18. Please turn to it. Page number 18, is it? Or page number 19, rather. Page number 19. Multiplication of fractions. At the very bottom of the page, you will see example number one, which is a very simple, very straightforward problem. Let's take a look at it. It says 4 times 5, or rather 4 over 5, 4 fifth times 1 half, times 1 half. If you find any common factor between the denominator and the numerator, we should reduce this quantity as quickly as we can. It saves a great deal of work. Don't carry it through. So we see a 4 here, we see a 2 here. 2 and 4 have a common denominator, common factor of 2. Let's divide top and bottom by 2. If you divide top and bottom by 2, 4 will become 2. And 2 divided by 2 is 1. So that's it. We are done. It's just 2 over 5. It's simply 2 over 5. There's nothing to it. Let's do example number 2. That was example number 1. Example number 2, we are on the next page. Page number 20. Please turn to it. Page number 20, the very next page. Page 20. We have 5 times 4 over 13. As you can see, there is no scope here for reducing the quantity, the numerator and denominator, because 13 happens to be a prime number. So we simply have to multiply it out. That 5 that we see there is same as 5 over 1. It's nothing different. You can write that 5, that we saw there is simply 5 over 1, because 5 over 1 is still 5. So we multiply the numerator, we have 5 times 4, which is 20. And then 1 times 13 is just going to be 13. Now we cannot leave it like this, because the numerator, the top, is more than the bottom. If the top is more than the bottom, it is an improper fraction. We must present it in a form of a mixed number. So we have to break up the 20 as 13 over 13 plus 7 over 13, because 13 plus 7 is 20. 13 over 13 is 1, so it's 1 and 7 13. That's the final answer. The final answer is 1 and 7 13. Let's go to number 3. These two are very simple, very straightforward problem. Very straightforward problems. What we're going to learn in number 3 is what's going to come in handy in the exam. So please pay close attention here. We have number 3. We have 2 and 1 8 times 5 and 5 6. Now, when you see something like this in the exam, before you dive in the problem and start solving it properly, the way you're supposed to, in an academic way, in a traditional, orthodox, classical way, before you do any of that, before you have that urge to solve this thing in a very academic way, ask yourself, is there a quicker way? Is there a way I can simply estimate the answer? Because many a times you can simply estimate an answer as long as you're able to arrive at a decent estimate. In most cases, you should be able to recognize the right answer. It's a multiple choice exam. Nobody's asking us what is 2 and 1 8 times 7 is 5x. No, 7 and 5 6. Nobody's asking us that. What they're asking here is that here are the 4 answer choices. Can you recognize which of them will be the representation of this quantity? Let's see what we can do here. For example, here, 7 and 5 6. Are you able to see that 5 6 is very close to 1? 5 6 is very close to 1. So 7 plus 5 6 is approximately 8. This quantity is approximately 8. This quantity is approximately 8, and that quantity is simply 2 and 2 and 8. Okay, watch what happens. Let's change the color so we can see it. 2 times 8 is simply 16. Plus 8 times 1 8. 8 times 1 8. What do you suppose you will have if you have 8 1 8s? An 8, an 8, an 8, an 8. If you add 8 of the 1 8, of course you will end up with whole. You will end up with 1. So that's just 1. This was 7, 16. So it tells us that the correct answer is something around 17. The question is, what we have to understand and what we have to realize here at this point, what we need to ask ourselves is, if you're going to do the estimation, you must always be fully cognizant of whether you have arrived at an underestimation or an overestimation, because that's going to tell you where to look for. If one answer choice is slightly more than 17, another answer choice is going to be slightly less than 17, at this point we have to be able to tell what is it that we're searching for. Are we looking for something more than 17 or something less than 17? Let's see what we can do. This was 7 and 5, 6. 7 and 5, 6, we approximated that as 8. 7 and 5, 6, we approximated it as 8. That's an overestimation. 8 is not 7 and 5, 6. 8 is more than 7 and 5, 6. 7 and 7, 7 and 6, 6. 7, 8 is 7 and 6, 6. Because 6 over 6 is 1. It's 5, 6. So this is an overestimation. This is an overestimation that tells us that the correct answer, whatever it is, has to be slightly less than that. This is how we show it. Put a negative sign on top and circle it. The correct answer, whatever it is, has to be slightly less than 17. And there is only going to be one answer choice that's going to be slightly under 17. And that's your answer. We don't have to actually do it out. If you sit there and actually do it out, it will take you forever and ever. Not only it will take you an inordinate amount of time, but there's also a very good chance that you might end up making mistakes, which is what they're hoping for. It will end up taking you an inordinate amount of time, and you will increase the odds of making an error. This is good enough. Now, if you don't like what I just did here, if you think that this is too rough, and if you want to do a little bit more proper work, which is not necessary at all, which is absolutely unnecessary, but if you're hell-bent on it, I'm going to show you another method. Another method of approximation, which is going to take a little bit more time. It's not going to add anything more to our understanding. It just takes a little bit more time. This is more straightforward method of estimation. Let's do a second one. Remember, what we have concluded is that the correct answer, whatever it is, it's got to be slightly less than 17. Let's see what the other method tells us. 2 and 1 8, 2 can be written as 16 over 8 plus 1 8. That's what that is. 2 is just 16 over 8 and 1 8, so that's 17 8. 17 8. Similarly, 7, so times 7 has to be written with the denominator of 6. 6 sevens are 42, so it's 42 over 6 plus 5 over 6. As you can see, this is getting a little bit more complicated. 42 plus 5 is 47, so what we end up is 47 over 6 times 6, which is 36, which is 36. What can we do here? Oh, no, 6, we don't multiply 6 times 6, it's just 6. What am I doing here? I lost train of my thought. We don't multiply the bottom part, we just simply 42 plus 5 is 47 over 6. 47 over 6. Okay, back. I'm back. Okay, which is why I don't want to do this method. It not only is taking too much, but it's not going to serve anything. At the end, the conclusion that we'll arrive at is that the final answer, whatever it is going to be slightly under 17. That's the conclusion we can arrive at. We have already arrived at that conclusion. Why is this all necessary? It's not necessary. This is not what I would do in the real exam. The previous method that we just did there, that's what I would do. Anyway, continue here. So we have 17 times 47, 17 times 47, and then 8 times 6, 8 6 are 48. It's 48. Now watch what happens. Would you agree that 47 over 48 is very close to 1, but not quite 1. It's slightly under 1. 47 over 48 is slightly under 1. That tells us that the final quantity that we get is 17 times something slightly under 1. This is how we write it, 1 with a negative sign on top. Well, if you multiply 17 by 1, 17 times 1 would have been 17. 17 by 17 times something slightly under 1 is going to give us slightly under 17. There you go. That's exactly what we said before. That's exactly what we said before. But there is no way in hell I'm going to sit here and actually do all the workout and like they show you in the book here, they tell you that 17 times 47 is 749, and then they divide 749 by 48 and they come up with a precise answer. The precise answer they come up with is 16 and 31, 48. To come up with an answer like that, it takes a lot of work, it takes a lot of time. It will end up taking you, as I said, an inordinate amount of time. That's not what you want. If you're looking for something under 17, there's only going to be one answer choice that's going to be slightly under 17, and that's right here. That's all. We're done. That's the answer. Do you understand? Let's learn this word. I've been using it quite often. I've been using it quite often here, two or three times I use the word inordinate amount of time. What does it mean, inordinate? It simply means excessive. It simply means excessive, unreasonable. If you try to do it the classical way, the traditional way, the orthodox way, the academic way, you'll end up spending excessive amount of time. You'll end up taking unreasonable amount of time. You don't have that luxury. When did we learn the word inordinate? I'm looking at here. Day number 72. Okay. Day 72. If you're interested in improving your vocabulary, watch the video. Here are the vocabulary videos, vocabulary words. Just type in vocabulary words, day number 72. Watch the video where we learned about inordinate, which means, as I said, excessive or unreasonable. You have to find a method that is more straightforward. A decent estimation is all that is required. If the problem is simple and straightforward, of course we'll do it out like we did problem 1 and 2. They were simple and straightforward. There is trying to estimate straightforward problem will actually end up taking you longer. But if something is complicated, something involves a lot of calculation, just estimate the damn thing. Do you understand? Just estimate the bloody thing and move on with your life. I'll see you tomorrow, okay? Bye now.